When you think capitalism, what do you picture? Maybe it's economic freedom. Maybe it's a giant pig on top of the workers. But what we can all conclude is that capitalism is often regarded as right-wing. Or is it? Charlie Kirk, Ben Shapiro, and other conservative libertarian YouTubers seem to have a large emphasis on personal freedom and liberty. The thing we must all understand is, this is truly the wrong stance we must take. Let's start in colonial America, that liberal nation of freedom and democracy. Except, let's consider that's not what the founders were, one, fully intending. They considered George Washington to even be a king. That already tells us what their thinking was. Two, sure, we can say America has freedom of religion, but remember too that the Constitution states that this was for a religious and moral peoples. Also saying how 99.99% of the population was, well, Christian. I am not suggesting we become some theocracy. I'm just saying that the Founding Fathers and colonial America was not some bastion of libertarian values. Probably most of the Founding Fathers were not that religious. But since America still had sodomy laws and still was very traditional, this shows us that the Founding Fathers knew the direction America would most likely take. What about guns? We have the right to bear arms. Well, yes, we do. But that doesn't inherently mean America was more liberal. America was still restrictive in many regards. Let's not forget prohibition laws. Now, was America really so pro-free trade? Well, take a look at Mount Rushmore. What do you see? Yes. Just note that they were all protectionists and used even harsher market protection policies than Donald Trump. For decades, America was not some crazy free market nation. America was not so capitalist back in the day. In fact, they could have been described as much more pro-big government, especially post-Civil War. The Republicans back in the day had power over almost all the institutions, while the Democrats were kicked down and only had an influence so great in the South. The Republicans, while yes, were pro-business often, they also had a very pro-labor area as a progressive part of the Republican Party as it emerged in the early 20th century. The point is, conservatives were not so libertarian. They were still pro-labor in some regards. This idea of history, of only the conservatives as pro-small government, is just false. Back in the day, we were not so conjoined with our party's ideals. It was much more politically diverse, with people and all kinds of ideas all over the platform they spoke in. The next point I will introduce is the rise of social conservatives. What is social conservatism? It's essentially an idea of having conservative values towards a society, much more than a libertarian individual sense. One good example was Otto von Bismarck. Europe traditionally was very big government, but that didn't mean it was progressive. Monarchs were crazy pro-big government, and as the liberals were destroying the monarchy for more ideas of liberté and equality, the monarchs and this idea of the church and state would be slowly rejected and eventually destroyed. Getting back to Otto von Bismarck, he was much more socially conservative, yet was not economically liberal or libertarian. His goal was to stop socialism, and so he would make highly socialized programs, not to the point of socialism, but a system good enough where it would unite more moderate socialists. According to the Smithsonian, quote, "So in 1883, with the passage of the health insurance law, Bismarck made Germany into a welfare state, all to stigmatize the socialists. The law was the first national system in the world," Steinberg says. "Both employers and employees paid into insurance funds, and the German government verified workers. Enrollment by comparing employer records with fund membership lists, threatening employers of uninsured workers with fines. The socialist programs proved to be correct play in almost every regard, as between 1884 and in the end of the century, blue-collar worker mortality rates fell 8.9%. Germany would also grow so fast economically, they would surpass the much more pro-free market nation of Britain." Social conservatism has also been on the rise in our modern day with parties like the AfD in Germany. These parties, though pretty right-winging socially, would be described economically much more moderate, if not on the traditional left. As these parties get more popular, it will eventually put pressure upon America to change up. If not, maybe even encourage smaller parties to rise and gain more popularity, creating new fringe ideas starting in America, if it will occur like that. The family unit doesn't need capitalism, as most of these corporations throughout history did everything they can to destroy the family unit. We notice two major factors for this reasoning. One, the rich tend to be atheist or at least not devout Christians. The elite will support anything most of the time since it benefits them. There are not many devout Christians, and the few that are most likely are not famous or really not the top tier in wealth. And number two, when the rich advocated on the right wing back in the 1800s, in America, they were not standing for conservative values, but conserving their money. Let's talk about point number one. According to Wikipedia and from American Heritage magazine, published the following list of 40 richest Americans ever in 1998, subtitling it, "Surprise, only three of them are alive today." The list was compiled by taking each person's wealth at death, adding the amount given away during his lifetime, and expressing the total as a fraction of the nation's GDP at the time. The list goes on, I'll just say the top 10. Number 1, John Rockefeller. 2, Andrew Carnegie. 3, Cornelius Vanderbilt. 4, John Jacob Astor. 5, Bill Gates. 6, Stephen Gergard. Sorry if I'm butchering them. 7, Alexander Turney Stewart. 8, Frederick Weishaupter. 9, Jay Gould. And 10, Marshall Field. With many others as for our top 40. And out of everyone on this list, about 7 of them reportedly showed support or donated to churches, and around 10 to 12 could be described as a Christian. However, it's hard to gather all this information with certainty, as many of these people were not so open about their faith. Some foreknown would be 1. Cornelius Vanderbilt was raised in a devoutly religious family and was known to attend church services. 2. Andrew Carnegie was raised in a devout Presbyterian household and remained connected to the church throughout his lifetime. And 3. John Jacob Astor was also affiliated with the Episcopal Church and was known to attend services. This ratio, 7 out of 40, gives us about 17.5%. Or if we were generous, we will go with 25%. Still, even with many of these people were for capitalist remarks, they also supported things like separation of church and state, laissez-faire politics, abolishment of the monarchy in other countries, and much more anti-religious ideals. For point number 2, to keep in mind about American 1800 politics, the Democrats were the Baptists, usually intended to be about smaller government. Though being more religious, this is more of a cultural thing than really the best interest of the country. Seeing how the North outpopulated the South, and now that we have the Western states, this shows us that the way we can go can't be the same Southern politics. And the North, led by the Republican Party, was progressive, yet highly lobbied and influenced by rich donors. The Republican Party, being so massive, was split in two groups. The establishment Republicans, who were about capitalist ideals and economic freedoms while being socially conservative, versus the progressives, who pushed more socialistic stances and were socially more liberal. Instead of the Republican conservatives ever pushing God, they would put most of the resources with pro-business ideals, which eventually destroyed their power when FDR came into place. The next thing I wanted to talk about was Asia, Africa, Japan, and China, and many other nations from pre-World War I. They were all anti-capitalist and anti-free trade. They saw this as these 5 points with an example from China's main reasons for being against Western democracy and capitalism. You know, the so-called true conservative values. 1. Historical context. China had experienced significant internal strife, foreign invasions, and economic instability during the 19th century. The Opium Wars and the unequal treaties forced upon China by Western powers weakened the Qing dynasty's control and exposed the country to exploitation by foreign capitalists. Number 2, cultural values. Traditional Chinese society placed a strong emphasis on hierarchical social structures and Confucian principles, which emphasized stability and order. Capitalism and free trade were seen as disruptive forces that could undermine social harmony and lead to moral decay. 3. Loss of sovereignty. Many conservatives viewed free trade and capitalism as tools of Western imperialism, threatening China's sovereignty and national dignity. They saw Western economic practices as a means of exerting control over China's economy and culture. Number 4, economic protectionism. Conservative Chinese elites often favored protectionist policies to safeguard domestic industries and to preserve the agrarian way of life. They feared that opening up to free trade would lead to the domination of foreign goods and the destruction of traditional livelihoods. And 5, fear of social disruption. Capitalism was associated with rapid industrialization and urbanization, which could disrupt traditional agrarian communities and lead to social unrest. Conservatives, elites, were way of the social upheaval that could accompany capitalist development. Overall, conservative Chinese opposition to free trade and capitalism in the early 20th century was rooted in a desire to preserve traditional values, protect national sovereignty, and maintain social stability in the face of external pressures and internal challenges. Many other empires would resist capitalism, as they saw this as a poison and would hurt their sovereignty, their way of life, and their tradition. Were they wrong, though? Capitalism has done many good things, but in the process hurt the state and enforced a global world by selling out our values. I can list many examples of companies and private organizations doing this, like the Rockefeller Foundation, Disney, Bud Light, and Target. And don't even mention the media. I don't want to talk about CNN and MSNBC since we already know enough about them. No, the bigger picture we must look at is how far does this go? I want to first mention why they all act like a hive mind. Let's take a look at BlackRock and Vanguard, two very evil corporations. These companies own over 10% of almost every corporation in America. Since I don't know too much, I will link these videos if you want to know more, but the point is that these companies are not conservatives, they are not Christians, and if we continue supporting this GDP worship, eventually we will be destroyed as a society. Now, you might think I'm a Marxist or socialist. I am not a Marxist, I am not a socialist. In fact, I am anti-Marxist and anti-socialist, just as much as I can be anti-capitalism almost. I do believe there are benefits of capitalism, but it's self-evident that capitalism has only led to an anti-religious and much more secular approach to our nation and many others. But politicians who, you know, will advocate for free trade and all that stuff will say, you know, but that we love Jesus. God bless your heart. We love Jesus. To quote the Bible, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do many mighty works in your name? Then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. Some of them will advocate for traditional values, but what have they actually done? Ron Reagan is a perfect example, as he granted amnesty to nearly 3 million illegal immigrants. Ronald Reagan said himself he was a libertarian.
I think that the heart of my philosophy is much more libertarianism. Than the conservative so-called is the one that says, less government, get off my back, get out of my pocket. And let me have more control of my own destiny.
And not only that, but Ronald Reagan also called the Soviet Union, when we were making peace, an evil empire. How old are you? He also then failed to back on abortion. I would not describe Trump as a true conservative, yet he was the only Republican that stopped Roe v. Wade and gathered Black and Hispanic support. The problem is not that Republicans are not going pro-libertarian enough, or they're becoming too much like Trump. It's that we left real conservatism for libertarianism, an ideology founded from liberalism. And at this point, it's just liberals versus libertarians. who are just cousins who fight over everything and can't make a compromise. So what now? Where do we go from here? I don't know all the answers, and I'm still so young, but what can I voice in my opinion? And I really want to talk about this since it means so much to me. Stop libertarianism. I will make a video soon critiquing the whole ideology, but to conclude the main point, capitalism is not evil, but I am someone who is anti-capitalist for three main reasons. 1. Money above God. When Judas rat out on Jesus for money, he was given what was described as blood or cursing money. Money is not everything. When you obsess over your physical wealth, it only leads to sorrow. It's about the Lord. It's something above yourself. But not to sound like a Marxist, but money is worth nothing until we give it value. Don't let the money become a false idol to worship. 2. A lack of ethics. If I were the businessman, would it benefit me to exploit people for my own gain? It's not wrong since I'm profiting off of that and making a service for people. That's the logic. In capitalism, most of the time, you have no real moral compass, and most Christian businesses fall down due to not playing the game enough, which is sad and unfortunate. Companies will play unethical games, and it's up to government to make sure companies are limited in their evil and human nature. And 3, a lack of anything more fulfilling. Corporations have a lack of anything that's really fulfilling. There was the documentary I watched one night called Happiness. I highly recommend it. But to my point, it shows a man from Japan how he struggles to live in this cog every day, to the point where even when he has everything, he has nothing. He can have a giant mansion and enormous wealth, but he will only be wealthy in the material sense. Will he be happy in the spiritual sense? Will he be rich in the soul? Rich in anything above the material? The answer is no. I'm not saying work should be abolished or that we need to have even less hours. In fact, having good production can be very beneficial to humans. But my main point is find something above what's around you. Find something much more sacred and divine. To my conclusion, I'm again not a socialist. I'm anti-socialist. However, I'm also against capitalism and wanted to show that many other conservatives, especially in history, have shown this perspective, which I find the correct perspective when it comes to how to follow God in His Word. I would say we shouldn't be so highly political. That definitely goes for me too. But we can all understand now that helping and caring for the poor, advocating for certain programs, wanting a more balanced trade system versus a free market, and looking out for your community over yourself is much more holy than it is by neocons and libertarians as some democratic talking point. This is Bennett HP out. Thank you so much for watching this video. Please like and subscribe. I appreciate everything. And listen, I am not for socialism or for Marxism. In fact, I've made a lot of critiques towards them too. My point is just, I think the free market is flawed, and I wanted to talk about that. That's it. Thank you so much, and again, Bennett out.